हेलो,
हाँ इस
नहीं हमें ऑडिबल?
यार यार आड़ी निकला मैम शैल वी स्टार्ट
यस सर जी, वी कैन स्टार्ट।
ओके मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
Good morning, everyone. Department of Physics, Holy Cross College welcomes you all. And myself, Abita from 3rd BSc Physics. Intellectual property rights are the rights given to persons over the creation of their minds. Prayer is the action of talking to God with energy in order to achieve a purpose. So let's start the webinar by seeking the blessing of the Lord Almighty with a prayer song. It's a mark of our undying tradition to welcome everyone. Now I invite Ms. Asmia from 3rd BSc to propose welcome address.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome you all to the webinar organized by Department of Physics, Holy Cross College in collaboration with Institution Innovation Council. I am glad to welcome our secretary, Dr. Sister Geraldine Jayam, who is the guiding star of our department. Welcome, sister. Then I would like to take pride in welcoming our principal, Dr. Sister Anika Sophie. Her simplicity always an inspiration for each one of us. Welcome, sister. It's a big opportunity for me to welcome our chief guest, Dr. S. Joseph Aristotle, Honorary Secretary, Supreme Court Advocate on Record Association, New Delhi. I want to convey my heartfelt gratitude to you for accepting the invitation and presiding over this webinar on Introduction to Intellectual Property Right. Welcome, sir. Next, I welcome our head of the department, Dr. C. Nirmala Luis, who is the integral part of the department. Welcome, ma'am. I have dozens of program coordinators and organizing committee members who always support the vision and mission of the college. Welcome, ma'am. Last, I welcome all my friends. Once again, welcome each and everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Asnia. It's a warm welcoming. Now, I request Ms. Merisha from First MSc to introduce our chief guest, Dr. Joseph Aristotle.
The most powerful way to win an argument is by asking questions. It can make people see the flaws in the logic. Dr. Joseph Aristotle, a man of eminence, an advocate on record, exclusively practicing in the Supreme Court of India, with about 21 years of experience and expertise in the practice of constitutional, criminal, civil, and indirect tax laws, and has appeared in a catena of landmark cases that have set precedents. He was elected as Honorary Secretary of Supreme Court Advocates on Record Association on 22-2020. He was appeared in more than 235 reported cases of the Honorable Supreme Court of India. As a student, he led a team of more than 30 law students for the 11th student Lok Adalat in Devanahalli Taluk, Karnataka, and settled the highest number of cases in the history of students in 1996-97. Also in the year 2017, appeared victoriously in two landmark cases, that is, for the defense and achieved acquittal in 2G spectrum case, and for the prosecutions and attained convictions in the disproportionate over assessed case of Selvi J. Jalita. We are proud to have such a prominent person as our chief guest. Now, without any delay, I am glad to hand over the session to him.
Thank you, Merisha. Although I don't know if I require such a long introduction anyway, thank you so much. But I think the best part of my profile, I would like to say, is I am also from Nagarkoil, and I am from Ottakara itself. So, you know, it's very close to my heart that I have been invited here, especially to a college, to the place I belong from. Okay, to formally begin, I would like to address respected secretary, Dr. Sister Gerardine Jayam, respected principal, Dr. Sister Anne Purpert, respected program coordinators, the HOD, Dr. C. Nirmala Lewis, Ms. P. Aji Udaya, Ms. M. Abila Jabakween, the dear organizing committee who had organized this function and gave me this opportunity this morning, and my dear fellow students, or I can say the future inventors and innovators of our country. First of all, I express my ardent gratitude and my sincere thanks to all of you for having given me this opportunity to share my views about IPR in India. I would like to begin with a rider that anything that I would be sharing here is my personal view, and say in about, we will have the session for about 30 to 35 minutes. We'll try to make it quite interactive. And whatever I would be expressing is my personal views and not any views of the organization or the post I hold. So to begin with, I mean, I was advised to have a slide, you know, kind of presentation. So I'll just share my screen. Yes. Hello, is the screen visible?
First it was visible, but now
okay,
I think. Now okay.
Yeah. Okay. So dear friends, what I would like to say is, first, we are talking about intellectual property. So we would have heard of many properties, you know, like movable, immovable properties. You know, anything that you would want to own, basically, you know, anything that gives you a right to possess is something we normally call as a proper property. So legally speaking, we have a lot of, you know, properties. We can talk about movable properties. Then it can be movable properties like your automobiles, immovable properties like your asset like the house you own, example. Then we have tangible properties, intangible properties, etc. So intellectual property is that right, or is that intangible asset that you will have on your creation, on basically your creation, your novelty. That's why you see so many on the screen, you know, your ideas, your creations, your novelties, your authorships. So you have to own it. There has to be a legal sanctity or a legal recognition for you to own a property. So the idea of having intellectual property basically is to give you that right. So if you see, basically, I mean, if you have to read the different definitions that are on the screen, we have different definitions from different organizations, but it means the same conceptually. Now we have the WIPO, that is the World Intellectual Property Organization, who heads the international standards for it. So if you see here, it says, you know, the intellectual property rights have added the intrinsic value to all kind of products as unique creation and ideas. So I don't want to go reading it. You can just see the screen. So basically, it is a right that is given to you to stop others from using any unauthorized use. So the government, or in those days, the king and the queen, the chair, the main person, you know, the authorities give you that particular right for you to exploit it. Only you will have a right, so that your novelty is given recognition. So the idea is, once your novelty is given recognition, your work in any ways, in whatever different ways, like you see, broadly speaking, we have patent, copyright and trademark, broadly speaking, but there are many more other intellectual properties nowadays, although it just started with these three. The intention behind this intellectual property right is that only the creator will have a right to exploit it. Nobody else should have a right to it. Now, when you invent something or when you discover something, that right should be only to you. That right should belong only to you. So what happens in turn of this is, there is quality. The society has more legible goods in them. And when you have more creativity and more novelty, the country's placement in the intellectual property right in the world. Now, in the world, we have this IPR index. So once your country goes up in the intellectual property right index, many other countries would want to collaborate with your country. So a simple invention, a simple patent, actually speaking, directly contributes to the economy of the country. So it is not, you're not thinking small. You are all going to be the future inventors and innovators. Small inventions can change. Small innovations can change. And these changes directly contribute to the economy of the country. So this is the basic structure of the intellectual property right of any country. So you get a right. Once you have a right, nobody can illegally use it. If they use it illegally, then you have a right to get back what belongs to you in the way of civil suits or anything, or like damages, compensation, etc., which I will explain subsequently. And thereafter, once there is more productivity, that productivity contributes to the economy of the country. It creates labor opportunities, etc. So you may think it is just a minor right of an inventor, but it is a very significant right, and it is directly, I can say, it is directly related even to the economic growth of the country. Now, if you want to just have a very quick early use of marks, I have assorted the slides. This slide is directly from the IPR website. So if you see, I'll just give you some examples quickly. Initially, it was, I can say, considered in the Roman brickmakers originally started having an identification on the bricks, so that the person who is using the brick should recognize from which maker it was made. So in this way, they could know which bricks were strong, which were weak, and the strong bricks, of course, got more, you know, kind of more orders, and it built up their business. So this recognition was, you know, historically we see that it was there way back in 2nd century itself. Then we have the Chinese pots. These Chinese pots, basically these Chinese pots, they have, you know, they have embedded on them the period of the emperor, the name of the maker, the place of the origin, etc. So intellectual property right, if you see, goes way back, you know, very early days, to the way back to the 2nd century BC itself. Now, if you see, these are the basic needs. Now, if you see what may be the needs, now, like I say, you can see the cycle. See, once there is an indigenous creation, once you create, then you get an intellectual property right. Once you get an intellectual property right, it encourages innovation and inventions. Another person also wants to invent, or he wants to protect basically what he creates. Then it goes to, you know, for a better business. Then it safeguards your rights. If your right is infringed, then there is a legal action. And you get the first right to have the maximum economic benefit out of it. So this basically, this cycle gives you the requirement for IPR in today's structure of the economy. Now, if you see the objectives, I mean, this may not be much relevant, but we have an IPR policy in our country. And lately, we have 7 targets that has been kept. So we have IPR awareness. So this program and the programs that have been taken place in the in most of the universities, even which I am speaking, is a part of this awareness. Today, if I am talking to you, it is an outreach and promotion of this IPR awareness. So the objectives of IPR policy mainly was that. And then, you know, you have all this in the net. It may not be much relevant now. But why I brought this objective to you is because this may be a part of the IPR awareness, because now people need to be educated that they have a right to own their invention, innovation, their rights on their, on their literary works or anything that is novel, they have a right to own it. Now, broadly speaking, this is the classification of intellectual property rights. So we have something known as the industrial rights that you see towards the left on my screen. That is the patents, the trademarks, the industrial design and geographical indications. We more or less call it as industrial rights. And if you see the other side, we have the literary rights. That's the copyright rights. So broadly speaking, it can be defined as industrial, non-industrial, and under that we have the patents, trademark, industrial design, and geographical indications in one flow of rights. And on the other side, we have to do with, you know, this is more to do with literature, to do with fine arts. I can say it has more to do with literature, fine arts. So you'll see music, literature, art, broadcast, dramatic work, sound recording, computer programs, etc. Now, all these have different terms and different terms of recognition, which we'll see subsequently. So this is a very broad classification of intellectual property rights. Now, how the IPRs is administered in our country is basically like you see on the screen, you have the main controller. He's the Controller General of Patent, Designs and Trademarks. Now, he is responsible, if you see, the chart for the Patents Act, the Trademark, the Copyright, the Designs Act, the Geographical Indications of Goods Act, the Semiconductor Integrated Circuits Act, etc. Now for the other act, we have something known as the Biodiversity Act, then we have the Plants and Seeds Variety Act. For those acts, you can see the respective, if you see the bottom, you can see the Ministry of Environment is directly responsible for the Biological Diversity Act. Similarly, we have the Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Rights Act, which falls under the Agriculture and Cooperation. So now this is the, a bird's eye view of what an intellectual property right in India is, what are the requirements and why do we have it. Now, dear friends, what is very important I would like to share with you as an experience is, even if I'm not able to complete all the, the basic structures of the IPR, I would want to give some importance to this particular structure. It is very important, especially because if you understand this structure of IPR, trust me, you can understand patent, copyright, trademark, you name the act, you can understand. So please understand the flow of any intellectual property right. Or for you to understand any intellectual property right is basically only these significant structures what I have given here. These are the vital structures. I can say these are the pillars of any legislations based on which your patent or in your trademark or any of your intellectual property right is basically protected. So this is common. This is common to all the laws. Or if you want to understand IPR, you have to know the flow of this process. So it will be very easy for you to understand any intellectual property rights. That's why I thought first let me disclose this, structure of IPR. Let me reveal it to you, and share this small secret with you of how to know the structure. See, any intellectual property right that we speak about, firstly, we'll have a legislation. If you see this, for example, you have the Patents Act, the Design Act, the Trademark Act, Copyright Act, etc., etc. These are known as legislations. So first, you need to understand that there is a legislation. So if there is a legislation, that is, there is an act. There is an act that governs the protection, and there are rules which provides for the procedure. So first, you have to understand the legislation. Now, for example, if you're talking about the Patents Act 1970, then you will know in that what is the structure of the act. So the intention of the legislation first needs to be understood. For Patent Act, it's protection of patent. For trademark, it's protection of trademark. Then what happens when you violate it? When you don't violate it, what happens? All this comes under a legislation. It governs them. Next, dear friends, please come to the definitions. Now, normally Section 2 or Section 3 of any act, these are common in all acts. That's why I'm taking this as a common structure so that it helps you to understand any intellectual property, right? And that's why I'm dedicating more time to this particular screen. Next, you will have the definition. So if you take Section 2, for example, of the Patents Act, it would give you all the definitions. Normally, Section 2 or Section 3 is the definition. Below the definition, normally the statute itself gives you a meaning or illustration. Most of the times, if in case of any ambiguity, if you feel the section is tough to be interpreted, then the act itself provides. So that we call it as, you know, normally we call it as the meaning or illustration. Now, after your right is defined. Now, for example, if it is patent, then what is a patent will be defined in Section 2, and an illustration or a meaning of it is derived. Like, you know, it needs to be novel, there has to be an inventive step, and then there has to be industrial applicability. These three are mandatory. After it provides, then the act would always say, immaterial of whichever act it is, that how to apply and who can apply. So in case of a copyright, it is the author. In case of a trademark, in case of a design, it is a designer. In case of a patent, it is the inventor. So who can apply? So normally the act would provide on who can apply. After who can apply, it would also say how to apply. What is the procedure to apply? So now when you start a procedure to apply, the unique feature that if you have to recognize about the intellectual property right is, we believe in prior search. Now, if I have invented something or if I've discovered something, then I should first know whether it already exists. If somebody else owns that right. So normally in most of the intellectual property rights, if you see, the unique feature would be prior search or use. So normally this is done internationally. And what I would like to share here is something, we have something known as the convention treaties. So for example, for an illustration, if 10 countries come together and have a common treaty, then your patent can be recognized in all the 10 countries also on the consent of the countries based during their collaboration, when they have a particular treaty. We have so many treaties, I don't want to get into that. So you have a prior search. Now, after there is a prior search, then you know what is your stand. If it is, then you get a recognition for your novelty. After that, you have registration. Now, each act provides for its registration according to its own structure. Now, for patent, for example, we have something known as provisional. And after provisional, we have something known as complete. So first you make the moment you get a thought, the moment you want to invent. Now, when you feel that you're in the process of inventing something, you can file an application immediately, which is known as a provisional application, and keep that. Within 1 year of that, you have to complete your invention and give a complete specification of that. Like this for copyright, for trademark. So the process is same. After that, you will have, there may be minor changes in the procedures in the act, but the concept of the flow of a title, how you own or obtain it, flows in this particular manner. Then we have the term of registration. Now, if you take the term of registration, for example, for patent, it is 20 years. For trademark, it's 10 years. For GI, it depends. You know, we have different terms. So every right of yours has a particular term. So this term, what is the use of this term? For example, if you own a patent for 20 years, you are the sole owner of that right, and only you have a right to exploit it. So if any other person wants to make that invention of yours, he has to pay you consideration, what we call as a royalty. So this term protects you. Now, there are many ways in which you can exploit your right. Again, that is different in different fields. But the basic concept, the foundational concept remains the same, that you exploit it during this term. Some are renewable, some are non-renewable. Like in trademark, you can renew it. In patent, it sometimes it expires. Sometimes, you know, they try to do an evergreening. That is, they try to, you know, make a small modification, repatent it, which is not permissible. So, you know, in copyright, if you see, it is 60 years after the death of the author, if it is his original work. Then if it is a performer's rights, then it's about 50 years from the day of performance. So the term of this is very important, because this is the tenure. This is the time you enjoy your right. Now, next, we have something very important, that is infringement. So all the acts go in the same flow. Now, what is an infringement? Now, for example, you are having a trademark, which may be a very, you have made something unique. And when you're using the trademark, or you're known by your trademark, or you're known by your invention, if another person tries to, invent it or manufacture it in case of patent without your right, if he tries to manufacture it, in trademark, if he tries to, make it very similar. For example, the spelling may be different, but the way you pronounce it will be the same. So if they try to, infringe it. Now, for example, if there is a Darjeeling tea, and if the tea, for example, is produced somewhere in Karnataka or something, they cannot use the word called Darjeeling, because the consumer may think, it is not permissible, because that is what you call it as infringement. So whenever you violate any terms of it, any person violates any term of it, we call it as an infringement. Sometimes we call it as passing off. Now, passing off is basically it is a type of infringement. Like, for example, if you say Iyengar, there can be 2-3 spellings in that Iyengar's bakery. And, we have this Aquafina, which is very common. Now, there were some producers who were making it as Aquafin. Some were making it Aka, A-K-A, A-Q. Now, these are all infringements in which the original manufacturer can sue. So when there is an infringement, there has to be a remedy. So that is how the design or structure of any law is. See how well the legislation protects your right. First, it identifies who deserves to be the holder. Once it identifies, then it recognizes them. It confers on them the right and protects them for that particular period. And during the protection, if there is any infringement, then there should be remedies. Now, in our country, most of them are civil remedies. Like, for example, you can go to a court, you can file a suit for stay. You can get a stay, you can get an order that stops any other person from, producing the same item, or you can pay for compensation. Now, for example, if I would have they have some yardsticks of measuring this compensation. Now, for example, if the inventor would have, for example, made about 5 lakhs in 2 months, and if that person has produced that particular material for 2 months, then he is minimum liable for at least about 6 to 7 lakhs, apart from the damages that he would claim for violation of his patent. So, dear friends, this, if I should say, is something you need to bear in mind. That is why I have dedicated this, because this is, you all are science students, so you understand this is the basic structure. So if you understand this, it's like a formula, then whatever I say henceforth can be grasped by you very quickly. So the idea is, not to just go quickly, but also to ensure that I communicate and you also understand the concept. Once you understand the concept of the intellectual property rights, the framework of the legislation, the structure in how the country protects you, as well as ensures that you commercially exploit it, you are benefited, and that benefit only encourages you to make further inventions. So this we have seen. So now let us see. Now we'll go a bit quickly, because I will just tell you, we will try to have a quick look on the broad aspects of IPR in India. So that would be basically patent, trademark, and copyright. Let us have a glimpse of it. If time permits, we will try to get into designs, geographical indication, etc. But the common three intellectual property rights are patent, trademark, and copyright. Now, patent, if you see the screen, you will know it is basically to you know, it protects what is an invention. Basically, you can say patent is an invention, or it can even be, you know, it has to be new. It should not be on something that exists. So you can just see the screen. I mean, see now, you see it goes in the same flow. Now, what is a patent? Then how you make it, I mean, who makes it, then to prevent others from selling, making or using it. So the scheme of the act is same as what we had discussed, as what we had discussed here. So the scheme of every act will more or less flow in this particular procedure. So what is patent? Now you see, this is the letter that was written by Galileo for his patent request in 1474. And this was the patent that was granted. Now you can just, you know, read it while I narrate something about patent. Now, initially, if you see, if you take back the Greeks, way back in Greece, somewhere in the, I think in 500 BC or somewhere around that time, there were cooks who were producing some particular kind of dishes. So the king or the emperor made sure that that particular dish should not be, you know, cooked by any other cooks. And only that cook had a right to cook that particular dish for the next 1 year. So the emperor realized, by having conditions like this, you will have more varieties and more delicacies. At the same time, the cook is also encouraged, because he feels that particular dish can be used, or I mean, cooked only by him for 1 year. So he also endeavors, you know, he tries to make different dishes. So this is one of the old way of, you know, these are one of those few, I can say, historically, the patents that were made, although it was not very significantly organized or structured in a framework like we have today. Now we have this Galileo's letter, what you see here, what he had written in 1474. It was one of his first inventions about, you know, drawing water with a single horse, with less thing. He had asked for 40 years. If you see, it says in the second para, my grandmother writes for 40 years, but the emperor was, but as per that particular patent, that is the Venetian Patent Act, he was granted 20 years. You will see in the middle, it says that it has been granted for 20 years in the second line. Okay. Now, what are the conditions you need to satisfy? Like I told before, it is novelty, inventiveness, and usefulness. Or we can say novelty, then we say something on this inventive step. So the first is novelty, the second is inventive step, and the third is industrial applicability. I have just put it in simple terms as usefulness, because any product that has been done should be new, should be invented, and that invention should not be obvious in the society. Okay, it should not be obvious. And then we have and that invention should be useful. That invention, whatever you make, should in turn be useful. It should be utilized in the society. Now, what cannot be invented? We have, you know, this paucity of time. So you can just see the screen quickly. Normally, what has been invented, a small enhancement on it, or now, for example, one formula creates a particular, I can say, a particular product. That same formula cannot be rephrased and then try to be patented. So these are small things that cannot be, you know, that are non-patentable. Then you have methods of agriculture or horticulture. Now we have a separate act guiding them. Then other than microorganisms, so microorganisms can be patented, others cannot. Then methods, process, etc. Now we have the salient features, that is, we have the 1970 Act, which has about 23 chapters and about 162 sections. So this everything is there in the net, you know, whichever particular field of intellectual property right that you would want to know, you can get more details about them. So this is a quick look at the patent process. You know what I was telling you before, you first have to file an application, then there has to be a prior search, then there is a formal examination conducted whether you are the first creator or there is somebody else who has created it. Then it is published. Then if somebody else has a similar invention, they can object. They can say, no, I have invented this before him, and they can produce evidence to that. And then we have the opposition proceedings, etc. So this is a quick look at the patent process. Then we have the validity for 20 years, what I've already told you. And then we have this infringement, like I told you, that's why I gave the structure first. So you have an infringement, that is somebody using your patent without your knowledge. And now indirect infringement can be through somebody else or in the process of, in the process of passing off. And there are so many other ways they can do it. So basically the thing is there are these infringement, and for the infringement, there are the remedies that are provided. The act itself provides. Now you have the, you can, you know, file a suit for injunction. You can claim damages on account of profits. Like I told you before, the small example, you know, if you are getting 5 lakhs, then they have a particular way of calculating it. So these are some remedies that are available. Now, this is something, utility patent is something which I had actually dedicated my thesis upon. I've done about 4 years of study on this utility patent. Now, a simple way of telling this utility patent is, now what you see on the screen, I mean, I don't know if I'm visible on the screen. Am I visible on the screen? Aji? Am I visible on the screen?
Yes, sir.
I'm visible, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now if you see this glass, you know, you can see a glass. You think this glass is an invention, for example. I'll just differentiate utility patent. Now, if this glass is an invention, and if one of you feel, see, when I'm trying to pour water from here, you know, it spills from the side. So if one of you feel that if I can give a small, you know, kind of beaker to it in the side, a small beak to it in the side, so that when you pour the water goes into the glass, it doesn't pour outside. Now, this small beak that you're going to give to this glass is something we known as an utility patent. So this enhances, you know, it increases the performance on this particular glass. Now, this is something which is actually recognized throughout the world, but it is not recognized in India. So I had taken up this 4 years of study, and I've drafted a law now, which consists of about 43 sections. And it is my lifetime project. You know, we are trying to have that enacted. Now, see, these are all utility patents. Now, if you see, a common man makes such wonderful innovations and inventions, but these are not protected. Because in our country, we have only patents, and patents are very rigid. Like I've already discussed with you, there has to be novelty. There has to be, you know, kind of non-obviousness, etc. Now, if you see this sugarcane machine where my cursor is, if you see this sugarcane machine, this man has assembled, you know, different inventions together. He has assembled different inventions. So the art of assembling them together is his innovation. Now, in the same machine, if you see, there is only one motor where my cursor is. Now, from the single motor, he produces the juice here. Then you can see the wheel and the steering here. The vehicle also, if you see on the left, there is a steering here, if you can see. So he uses the same machine to the same motor to produce sugarcane juice and to ride that, to drive that particular entire system, you know, to the mobility of that entire machine for him to sell it in different places. And in the night, you believe it or not, it produces the same thing, produces electricity also. No? It has a small dynamo due to which he gets lights. If you see here, there are some design lights here, like these ones. So this is known as utility patent. I mean, anyway, but this is something we need to get into our country, which I'm really working upon. And hopefully, by God's grace, I do it. And, you know, we get that act. So we have drafted an act, and now we are following it up with the parliament. We are trying our level best to have it legislated. So what will happen is, even a common man's invention, a common man's innovations will be protected in our country. So once your inventions and innovations are protected, like I told you, your level in the intellectual property right of the world increases. And once it increases, there are more collaborations, investments, and in turn, the economy of the country, you know, gets increased. So this is the scheme of any intellectual property right. Now we are, let's see, next is a trademark. So now trademark, if you differentiate from patent, basically, I've given so many trademarks here. You can see it on the screen. So we have this, basically any symbol or design, logo, phrase, image, etc., which connects you to a particular, the creator or the owner of that particular company. Now, for example, if you see a tick mark, then you know it is Nike immediately. Now, if you see that M, then you know it's MACD. Now the WhatsApp has that, you know, small phone kind of symbol. So these are all trademarks. So once you have these kind of trademarks, then another person is not permitted to make the trademark. That is what I was saying, is something known as a passing off. Now if because once you're, once they may not know the owner, but they may know the product by the trademark. That's how a consumer identifies it. Once he identifies it, then he is protected. That particular trademark and the identity, basically identity is the keyword in trademark. That identity has to be unique, and that connection to the particular maker is always protected. These are some types of trademarks that you see. And trademark is offered for 10 years. And after about 10 years, they can have it renewed. And they have to ensure that it is still there in the market. There are some procedures for it. You have about 10 types of different, you know, trademark that are available and the filing applications. And then we have, you know, the different ways how you register a trademark. So if you see in the screen, I've explained what is passing off and what is the statutory protection that you get. And even in trademark, the common, the remedies that you have is suits, you know, injunctions. And, you know, there are many other remedies that are available. Now we have copyright. Now, in copyright, we have this term, you know, if you see what is a copyright, you will see here, literary, musical, artistic, dramatic, recording, broadcast, etc. These are different kind of, you know, works that are protected against the copyright. So you will see this unique mark what you get. So basically, in our country, it is not very mandatory for you to register your copyright. But when you want to seek action against your copyright or based on your work, there has to be a copyright. Only then you will be able to initiate action if somebody else has copied your work. So if so, very interestingly, if I recollect, one of the oldest copyright violations, if I have to share with you, was somewhere in the 557 AD. So there was this writer, I think his name, I forgot his name, it was Finian, I think, and his student called Abator. Or I think the student's name was Abbot of Finian. So this student, when he visits his teacher, he takes his book, he copies it, and he distributes it. Once the author of the book comes to know about it, the teacher comes to know about it, he writes to the emperor. And that famous quote is known even today. You know, he writes to the emperor stating that to every cow her cough, to every cow her cough, and consequently to every book its copy. Like how the calf belongs to a cow, similarly, a copy of a book belongs to the author. So he writes this one-liner, which is very famous even until today. Any copyright lawyers, you know, would use this term in their arguments and others, that to every cow her calf, and consequently to every book its copy. And then we have, you know, a quick look at the copyright registration. This is again the same. That is why I took more time in educating you or sharing with you the scheme of the act. Once you have understood, now you will see it's so easy to understand everything because it flows in the same way. So you have the process here, you file the application, it takes about 2 to 3 weeks. Then, you know, there is some time to see if somebody else is having it. Once it's accepted, then you're given a registration. Then you have the term of copyright, which goes for about 60 years, the registration of it, etc. Now, here there's a quick comparative analysis. If we have time, you can just see the screen. It's a quick comparative analysis of these three, because these three are the main, you know, the main acts, that the main intellectual property rights are basically the copyright, trademark, and patent. Now, if you see, this is gone by the 57 Act, this is by the 99 Act, and this is by the 70 Act. This, in fact, has been amended thereafter. The last amendment was in 2005. Although the act is of these years, there have been many amendments. The Trademark Act has also been amended. Now, you see the types of work here, it has to be. It is more on literary works and artistic for copyright. For trademark, you can see slogans, logo, etc. And here it is invention. Now, if you see validity for copyright, it is 60 years from the time of author. For trademarks, it is 10 years from the time of the trademark and can be further renewed. And this is 20 years. If you see, it is a territorial thing, only within the territory of India. Then we have, you know, what it secures. This secures your intellectual creations, like your authorship, your rights. This secures your brand, basically trademark, and this secures your invention. Then your right comes into existence the moment you make it. Here, the moment you have a claim, you know, of the mark and claim complete right over the said mark, 12 to 18 months from the time of registration. Same with the patent thing. from when you make your registration. So basically, when your right comes into existence is the right, is the day from when you can say that somebody else cannot copy or somebody else cannot infringe, or you have a right to take action against somebody who infringes it. Then we have the provisional application, what we have already discussed. So now next, we can just take a quick look for about 5 minutes on what is designs. Now designs, you know, like I was showing you now, for example, if you see this glass, this particular design is something the designer holds. Now this design is not an invention. Even if when you give a beak, it doesn't come under the Design Act, but it comes under the utility patent, like I was telling, because it enhances the performance. But when you see this color, the line, the pattern, everything, this we call it as a design. Well, similarly, you have, you know, how a design, what requires to be there in design. It's more or less the same, again, the kind of infringement and relief. Then we have the geographical indications. This is also something very important, especially picking up on these days, because geographical indication is known from the place of origin. The nearest example that we can give for Nagarkoil is Tirunelveli Alva. For example, the way the particular Alva is made, and if it is related to Tirunelveli, then it has to be produced only in Tirunelveli. You know, it is a collective right that belongs to the applicant. Usually they have associations who apply for this right and then procure it. So we have the 2003 Act. And you see here, any name, that's what I was saying, any name, geographical or figurative representation or any combination of them. Now we have the Darjeeling tea, which is a very common example for this. Then we have the Tirupati Laddu. Then we have the, you know, Alfonso thing, you know, mangoes. Then the Basmati, the thing for Basmati, the recent dispute they had with regard to that. If you see, there are some, you know, if you see the screen, all these are basically known. But one thing that requires here is, over a period of time, if it gets generic, then there is no cover, you know, then you cannot claim. For example, if you see vodka. Vodka, a spirit that was used in Russia, was subsequently produced in Finland, Sweden, etc. And it lost that significance of having related to that place of origin. So that place of origin has to be procured, you know, that right has to be secured at the earliest before it reaches anywhere else. So they cannot reproduce it, because that product gets its uniqueness, or what you procure under the GI Act procures its originality from its origin. So now, for example, the Darjeeling tea, it can be produced only in Darjeeling. That's because of the soil, the climatic conditions, etc. So like that, every, you know, you see all those different examples on the screen, they are all known to the place of origin. Now, this is a similar flowchart that I've given. So, and again, you know, infringement, if somebody else, you know, tries to use it, then what kind of right is available to you? Then you have civil remedies like injunction, damages, etc. You have this, some of these case laws here, like the Scotch whiskey, which is a very well-known case in it. Then we have, So now, after the GI Act, what I can say is an international agreement. Now, see, these basically now we have many agreements. You know, it may, the idea of sharing these agreements with you is, I don't want to get into them. It's now basically that these countries who come together try to make themselves a very common kind of features. Now, for example, TRIPS, if you see the trade-related intellectual property 1994, this meet, they mandated that if you are a member of TRIPS, then you have to have this basic kind of laws and these basic kind of facilities or features available to the innovators, creators, inventors, etc. So in view of that 1994 membership that we have in TRIPS, the Patents Act was amended, the Trademark Act was amended. We subsequently came out with new acts, you know, to protect the circuits, then to protect the plants, etc. That is to show that we have complied with these kind of mandates that arise in this agreement, and we are also in consistence with the other countries. Now, for example, if you take the Patent Cooperation Treaty, now this is a PCT. If you are a member of PCT, like India is a member of PCT, so when you file a patent, it can be either in India or in PCT. So the search happens in India as well as in PCT. So like I told in the beginning, when you have this kind of collaboration of these countries, they come into a kind of arrangement and a mutual relationship in which they can share these inventions, the rights basically. And so the more your right is protected globally, the more there is chance for you to exploit it, and the more the country also improves its economy. These are some websites. I mean, you would get that in Google. So before I conclude, dear friends, I would again insist on this first thing what I was sharing with you, because I feel these acts you will surely understand. But what requires more attention, I would say, is back to the structure what we were discussing. You know, I would like to give importance to this. So, dear friends, please, and I mean, you would have, I hope, you know, I have made some things clear to you, hopefully. But please understand, from the morning we wake to the night we sleep, there is always an intellectual property. The toothbrush you use, the paste you use, the bucket, the mug, the taps, the books, everything has a creator, everything has an owner. Of course, God is a universal creator, but subsequently, everything that came was created by man. So every creation, the author, the owner, the inventor, he has a right. That intangible right, we call it as an intellectual property right. So that intellectual property right is deserved to be exploited only by the creator and the owner. Thank you all for this time in the morning. Wish you all the very best. God bless you all.
Thank you, sir. We will go ahead and take some time for questions.
Sure.
Dear participants, if you have any queries, you can post in the chat box.
Girls, if you have any queries, you can either type in the chat box or you can unmute and ask your queries.
I think I've confused all of them.
I think students have no queries.
Okay. Thank you, Ajik. Okay, so I thank you all for this opportunity again. It was very close to my heart that I got to address. Although I'm in Delhi, more than, you know, so thousands of kilometers away, it's so close to my heart that I got to got an opportunity to address you all. I feel so much homely and being there in, you know, Nagarkoil, and especially the campus, because I grew up around the campus from Vatakara only. That is why. So I thank you all again. I thank the, especially the HOD, Dr. C. Nirmala Lewis, and as well as the Honorable Secretary and the Principal for this opportunity. I especially thank Ajji also, who's none other than my own cousin. I thank her also for having facilitated this program. I thank you all again and have a wonderful and safe day.
Thank you, sir. Now it's time to express our gratitude. I request Ms. Bernard Shano from First MSc to put forward the vote of thanks.
Every good and perfect gift comes from above. So is this day. I would like to express my gratitude to Joseph Sir. From 10 a.m. to 10:54 a.m., the session was purely meticulous. We had an interesting session after a long time. The concept, like small invention can change IPR awareness, did give us a gentle nudge in the direction of possibilities. Your lecture gave an insight into a wide range of precautions and procedure. Thank you, sir, for disintegrating the complexities of the patent process and explaining why we need to know about intellectual property rights. You also enrich us with the possibilities of how our ideas could change the world. A motivation word kept the session well articulated and lively. The utility patent added the right amount of spice to the conclusion. You also explained the power of combination of intellectual property rights with your personal view. You refreshed our mind with your nuggets of wisdom. Thank you, sir. I would like to extend my gratitude to the management, our beloved secretary, Dr. Sister Geraldine J.M., and our beloved principal, Dr. Sister Annie Perpet Sophie, to have graciously consented to cause this webinar. Thank you, sisters. I would independently to thank our HOD, Dr. C. Nirmala Louis, for her untiring efforts in making this event possible. Thank you, ma'am. I also extend my thanks to Ms. P. Aji Udaya and also Ms. M. Abila Jeba Queen for their enormous cooperation in the organization of this event. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the staff members for their inevitable contributions behind the screens. I would like to thank the dignitaries for their honorable presence. My ode would be incomplete if don't thank our participants for their enthusiastic participation. Thank you all. Have a great day.
Feedback form is posted in the chat box. Kindly fill it carefully and get your certificates. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation.
Thank you, doctor.